question which we must decide as to whether or not we are here as the result of the laws of biology, and we must, as human beings, learn to coexist with one another, or whether we are here in consequence of some divine design which may have plans for us that have nothing to do with our own sense of our free will or our solidarity that you have.
Deus não é grande é o título do novo livro do inglês Christopher Hitchens, um dos mais brilhantes jornalistas da atualidade. Ex-trotskista que se libertou das ideologias para defender, com a mesma veemência, a condenação do ex-secretário de Estado Henry Kissinger por crimes contra a humanidade e a invasão americana ao Iraque, Hitchens, ateu convicto, mergulhou durante anos no universo complexo das religiões para traçar um quadro demolidor de todos os dogmas da fé manipulados pelos homens através da história. No livro de Hitchens não há salvação, nem nas religiões politeístas, nem nas monoteístas. Cristianismo, judaísmo e islamismo são interpretações de uma mesma invenção, em nome das quais se cometem atrocidades. A fé acorrenta bilhões de pessoas aos preconceitos contra a mulher, contra o sexo e contra o desenvolvimento da ciência. A religião envenena tudo. Foram essas as ideias que Hitchens veio defender em Porto Alegre, no ciclo de conferências Fronteiras do Pensamento. E sobre elas falou também ao Milênio, convicto de que só a busca da verdade, guiada pela razão, é capaz de proporcionar a verdadeira caminhada do homem em direção a um novo iluminismo.
Christopher, let's try to follow for a while the chronology of your book and go back to Dartford, England, when you were a 90-year-old boy, back to Mrs. Jean Watt's classes of religion. She seems to be the first person that helped you to doubt of God's existence unintentionally. I guess everybody has gone through a similar experience in a certain stage of life, but the truth is that no matter how dogmatic and irrational the introduction in religion is, billions of people still prefer to embrace faith. How do you explain this uncontrollable need of God among human beings?
I can only say that if we have to concede that for millions of people it's very real and very necessary, then we must also concede that for quite a large number of us, perhaps 10 to 15%, this need does not exist. And for me, Mrs. Watts didn't tell me anything I didn't know. I did not suddenly have a moment on the road to Damascus. I used to believe something and now I don't believe it anymore, or I used to believe this and now I believe something different. No, it was simply the way in which I discovered that I couldn't believe in the supernatural. Did not believe in it, could not believe in it. Mm. It's something a little different from a moment of conviction or from a eureka type moment, but still a moment. It became obvious to me that I was, as Pascal phrases it, so made that I cannot believe.
As you say, you have written this book your entire life.
Yes.
If this long way...
It's very kind of you, by the way, to notice this acutely.
But this long way that took you to your unquestionable objections to religious faith, was it easy or was it painful?
I think it was less painful than the experience that many of my Christian or Muslim or Jewish friends have had of investing many years of their lives in a faith that proved to them to be worthless. Mm. For me, it's an intellectual engagement with believers and with unbelievers, trying to make people understand that the most beautiful life is the one that studies reason, irony, literature, science, humor, and the other things that make one's life worth living, that we don't owe anything to a supernatural dictatorship.
I wonder if this has something to do with our fragility, our essence of glass, This is a beautiful definition of the French scriptwriter Jean-Claude Carrière, who wrote about our fragility, a sense of glass.
There's no doubt of it in my mind. We are a partly rational species that is full of fear, fear of death, fear of the unknown, fear of the dark. That is also a very conceited species. Unlike most other animals, we believe that the universe is designed with us in mind. It's easy to persuade us that this is not an accident. We must be the center of the object for this, of course. Now, between our fear and our egotism, it's extremely easy to sell religion to us. Of course, we would be the center of the world. The sun revolves around our earth. Nothing would be more likely. Everything is about me. Moi. Yes, it takes a lot to grow out of this nonsense.
Your book fully illustrates how harmful religions have been throughout the centuries and how many atrocities men have committed and still commit in the name of God.
Not in the name of God, because of the belief in God.
But at the same time, there are reasons behind it. And these reasons are the constant struggle for domination and expansion, as well as the constant fear of the different, fear and despise for the different. Do you believe that without religion, this struggle would come to an end?
No. I'll give you an example. Christianity is stolen from Judaism, and Islam is stolen from Christianity and Judaism. These are plagiarisms, but the original monotheism is that of the covenant between God and the Jewish people, supposedly. Mm-hmm. Well, according to the Jews, God tells them to pray every morning. The men have to say, "Thank God I'm not a woman." And the women have to pray, "Thank God I am the way I am." And both have to thank God that they're not a Gentile or a slave. Well, obviously, this is not decided by God, it's designed by man, by men, to be exact, masculine, so that they can keep women in their place. That's easy. Only a fool can't see that. Okay? God did not decide this. Men used religion to own women. However, the impulse of men to own women would be there if they believe in God or not. It's just that it might be a bit harder to persuade female babies that they should be owned by men if they were not told that God wants it to be true. If all they're told is men want it to be true, they're not going to be very surprised. Tell them that God wants it to be true, then they may put up with it. The same with slavery. God wants people to be slaves? That's different from just men wanting to own other people. So that with the use of religion, the invention of the deity, you can disguise what would otherwise be obviously a man-made, ramshackle, hypocritical dictatorship. So that getting rid of the idea of the supernatural is one step, only one, but a very important one, perhaps the first one, perhaps the biggest one, on the road to emancipation.
Until reading your book, I never realized how many divine creatures have been born from virgin women as Mary. You say Buddha, Krishna, Perseus, Horus, Mercury.
Several Aztec gods. I think there's no god that I know of in history. I have a whole paragraph of this.
That have been.
I say history, in mythology, that has not been born of a virgin. It would have been impossible for Christianity to sell itself as a religion if it did not continue this Egyptian, Aztec, Persian, Mongol tradition. Even Buddha is born from a slit in his mother's side. Anything but the birth canal, anything but the vagina. This unclean vessel, God has for some reason used only one way street.
But was this the eternal fear of sex, or perhaps the need that make an origin for God that would be different from the human biological system?
It's the religious fear of sex, certainly, but it's also the male revulsion from what it most desires. Men need women, and they don't like the fact that they need them. They need them terribly. They hate the fact that they need them. They experience the disgust about this fact. Religion makes that into a system and consecrates it. My first wife was Greek Orthodox, Eastern Christian. Mm-hmm. when she was having her monthly period, she wasn't allowed to go to the church. Certainly not to take the sacrament of Mass. I think that used to be true, at any rate, of the Western Orthodox, the Roman Catholic as well. It's certainly true of Judaism. And the revulsion from female menstrual fluids is very common, of course, also in Islam and in all other cults. This comes from human anthropology. It does not come from heaven. It does not come from the sky. It doesn't come from the planets. It doesn't come from the sun and the moon and the stars. It comes from the base, very primitive forms of human anthropology. It's the first thing to know about it.
Let's take a look at the three monotheist religions. You have been submerged in the readings of the scriptures of the same story told in three different ways. But it was not very clear for me your own view on the three mostly known men in humanity, Moses, Muhammad, and Jesus. Tell us about them.
Moses is a mythical figure, invented many centuries after he died. There are probably four authors of what is called the Torah, the Jewish Bible, the Pentateuch, the first five books of the New Testament.
Invented.
Biblical scholarship suggests at least four authors, contradicting each other, sometimes synthesizing each other. Nobody except the fanatical Orthodox Jews believes that Moses was the author of the Torah, or that God dictated it to him. He's the author, in other words, at second hand. Muhammad, of whom it's also said that he dictated a book at God's, or the Archangel Gabriel's dictation, is not quite so much a figure in mythical legend. There probably was such a person. It seems quite likely there was such a person, that much of what we know about him is legendary. He's on the borderline. But Jesus of Nazareth is much more on the borderline. Earlier, between the two, he's more in the world of William Tell, Robin Hood, King Arthur, the legendary figure. Certainly most of what was written about him and what is claimed is written, as with Muhammad, as with Moses, many hundreds of years afterwards, by people who didn't know him, who were themselves very parti pris, as the French say, very partisan. But the effort that they make to make the story come true suggests that there may have been some sort of human individual involved. In each case, it's the desire to fabricate a story that testifies to the strength of the belief.
How would you draw Jesus in his lifetime?
We only have, even at the claims of his supporters, written many years later, and very discrepant. None of the accounts agree about his birth, his life, his death, or his supposed resurrection. The four Gospels completely contradict each other on all these things. But let's suppose they're trying to do their best. There are a few years around his birth, childhood. Then there are about something like 25 or nearly 30 missing years. And then there's the return somewhere, somehow, apparently the same person, to roughly the same area, ending in a very horrible death. Or not ending in a very horrible death. For me, raising a question, a very important question, is it true for Christians to say somebody died for my sins when they did not in fact die? Which do they mean? I make it as a morally serious point, if somebody throws himself on top of the bomb that would otherwise explode in the schoolroom, he absorbs the explosion, loses his life to save other people, we can respect it. What if he isn't doing that? What if he's doing that and he's going to get up 2 days later and say, I'm unharmed? Doesn't it diminish the admiration one has for the sacrifice? You see what I mean? Christianity leaves all these moral questions entirely unresolved.
Coming back to the scriptures, you say that the Old Testament was a nightmare, but the new one was still more cruel. What was horrible about it?
The Old Testament I describe as a nightmare because it contains the warrant, the official divine warrant, for ethnic cleansing, as we now call it, the destruction of other peoples, actually for genocidal ethnic cleansing, the complete destruction down to the last child of the Midianites, the Amalekites and others. They're to be erased, obliterated, their land taken. If there are any survivors, preferably young female, they should be made into slaves, and so on. But here's the warrant for all this: slavery, genocide, murder of children, etc., and theft, conquest, dispossession, imperialism, the most arrogant kind. But that's it. Once the Midianites or the Amalekites have been destroyed, or the Moabites have been destroyed, that's it. They don't suffer anymore from not being Jewish or not having the covenant with God. They're gone, but that's it. There's no hell. But now we're going to torture you after you're dead forever. That completely evil idea only comes with Jesus of Nazareth, who says for the first time, if you don't agree with my lovely offer, depart from me and go into eternal fire. The most evil idea I think has ever been proposed in history, now very much preached by the suicide murderers of Islam as a central teaching of their wicked doctrine.
On the other hand, your readings on the Quran made you say that Islamism is at the same time the most interesting and the less interesting of the monotheisms. Let's talk about the most interesting in Islamism.
Islam claims to be the culmination, maybe we should say the consummation, of the previous revelations, Abraham, Moses, Jesus, and so on. It doesn't deny these. It says these also occurred, but now God wanted to round it off, bring the last words, after which there's no need for any more inquiries. There are no more questions. All the questions have been answered now. All you need is to recognize the good news and to fall on your knees in front of it. Mm-hmm. Well, this is a very dangerous doctrine, of course, because it literally suggests that the time for human inquiry has come to an end. That we already have all the information that we need. Nothing could be more horrible than that. And it contains also, underneath itself, it contains a direct threat. If you don't agree with this, there's something really wrong with you, and you may have to be brought into line. And the measures taken may have to be very severe.
But this is very close to the other religions, the other monotheist religions too.
Yes.
I mean, it is of course true.
Mr. Ratzinger, Herr Ratzinger, the Bavarian who calls himself the Bishop of Rome, and is called by his supporters, but not by me, the Pope, has recently said that only the Roman Catholic version of Christianity is the true faith. And of course he has no choice but to say this. That is indeed the teaching of the Church, and he wanted to reaffirm it. There had been some weakening on this point. They've been saying that since before the Prophet Muhammad. But the difference, I think, is this. There is no denunciation in the Christian Bible of the Muslim teaching, whereas the Muslim teaching says, oh yes, we understand the Christian Bible, we come after it, we're the final, we're the last. It's more analogous to what Christians say, some of them say, about the Jews, either that they got everything wrong and that they killed Christ and the heretics, or sometimes when they're in a good mood, that they got everything right, they invented monotheism, and all they need is to realize that the Messiah has already come. You're not waiting for him, he already arrived. My view as an atheist is that all religions are equally false. They're false in the same way. They prefer faith to reason.
There's also a very interesting chapter in your book, the most generous, I would say, where you make the question, do religion make people behave better? And surprisingly, you say yes when you speak about Martin Luther King.
No, I say no.
I understood that you had...
No, I say that the case for civil rights for African Americans, black Americans, was complete long before Dr. King was born, and had been made by atheists and secularists. black atheist and secularist.
To recognize the important role he had. That rhetorically,
for someone, the justification for racism and for slavery was Christian, specifically Christian. So that it's very brilliant rhetorically to be able to use the language of Christianity, dialectically, so to say, against itself. But it adds nothing to the proof that racism and slavery are to be condemned morally, to be able to do it in New Testament or Old Testament terms, the case had already been made. It's just a great propaganda victory, a great rhetorical victory. It doesn't make anyone behave. Religion has never made anyone behave any better. We can certainly not say, however, that it has not made people behave worse, because otherwise there wouldn't have been the Christian justification for slavery for 2,000 years, and the Jewish justification before that, to begin with. All the justifications for slavery are religious.
You belong, of course, to a small and selected group of evolutionists who proposes a renewed illuminism centered on man. Man is the main object of study. People as Richard Dawkins and Daniel Dennett, who call themselves the brights.
Let me put it like this. I cannot claim inner brightness for myself. If you want to say you see it in me, I'm on it. But I can't tell you you ought to be seeing it. That would be arrogant on my part. I'm also not certain that we say that the center of the system is human, or is mankind. In fact, we've spent a long time trying to show people that it was the church who wanted to persuade us that the whole universe was centered on us. That's why they didn't like Galileo. They wanted us to believe that the sun went around the earth, that the whole of the universe was centered on our globe. We tell people to the contrary. We hardly even live in the suburbs, even in the outer suburbs of the known universe. And it's time that we realize how very small our role in this is. And only when we understand our sense of proportion are we likely to be able to think rationally about it.
But inner brightness is also a definition of God, and there are others too. For instance, I picked up one from the leftist philosopher Tony Negri, who is not exactly a religious person, and he says that the only possible definition for God is the excess, the superabundance, the joy.
Excess or superabundance. What there is a huge...
There is not.
No, there isn't. But there's a huge deficit. We don't use our reason enough. We have faculties of reason and inquiry and skepticism that we neglect. We don't overuse them, we underuse them. It would be a great day if there was a surplus value to this. But there isn't.
Anyway, can we believe that humanity is moving forward to this brightness?
I don't think we're moving forward at all.
Not at all?
No. I think at the moment we're moving backward. I think the forces of theocracy are growing faster.
All over the place?
And with more confidence, yes. And with more violence. With greater numbers than the forces of reason are doing. I think that the period of human enlightenment may look in retrospect like a very brief, very small fraction of a second in human evolution between about 1680 and about now, and maybe about to go into eclipse.
Well, thank you very much, Christopher. It was very nice talking to you.
Nada.
Let's hope for better times.
Well.